Kasalukuyan pong may pagdinig sa Senado kagnay sa disaster response kasunod nga po ng paghagupit ng super bagyong Yolanda sa Eastern Visayas. Pakinggan po natin ang bahagi nito.
Pitilia, as the head of a task force to do a needs assessment. So what this committee would like to know also is how all of these three components work together. Where will the findings of Secretary Pitilia factor into the work of the Rehab and Reconstruction Committee headed by NEDA? And will this be handed over eventually to the Rehabilitation SAR? So may I again move that the personalities involved in clarifying these issues be invited in the next setting. Now, second matter, Mr. Chairman, we have invited several of our colleagues from the House who have also been affected by the other disasters prior to Yolanda. Now, if for lack of material time, they will not be afforded the opportunity to engage our resource persons, may I just encourage my colleagues to touch base with our resource persons even after the hearing. Now, proceeding with my questions, Mr. Chairman, may I direct my question to the NDRRMC as to how it happens on the ground? For example, sir, we are aware that there were four regions, at least, who were affected by Yolanda. Now, if the National Council was supposed to be on top of this, I would imagine that they would have at least some secondary guy on the ground, and I'm referring to the regional DRR officer. May we know how he functioned during the entire period beginning the days or 2 days before Yolanda and the immediate period after Yolanda hit, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Actually, a few days before, 3 days before, the different regional councils were already informed about the about Yolanda and to conduct their pre-evacuation activities, preparation so that they will be more or less prepared when Yolanda arrives in their respective regions. And the regional directors convened a council meeting and they called directly the different provincial and municipal councils for their respective preparations. So, when Yolanda came, as stated earlier, the National Council actually was on top of the situation, especially in Region 8, with the chairperson himself on the ground before Yolanda made the landfall. And 24 hours after, we proceeded immediately to the Tacloban City on board C-130 with Secretary Dinky Soliman in Tacloban and provided relief goods. With regards to the security forces, when I arrived there on Saturday, they were all victims also. But on Sunday evening, augmentation troops came from Catbalogan City, which is based in Western Samar. So, and the following day, Monday, that was 11, PNP troops augmentation also landed in Tacloban coming from the national headquarters.
Sir, may I interrupt you there, sir? Mr. Chairman, may I ask if at all times where the regional DRR officer was, or if he was also yung sasalita natin, nasalanta rin ho ba siya? Or was he in a position to respond immediately and assist the member councils within his regional jurisdiction?
Well, at the time, when the typhoon hit, Your Honor, actually, he was alone by himself. The regional directors of the council were also victims. So when we held our night meetings in the evening, it was composed of personalities from the national and the regional director of the Office of Civil Defense himself. It was only on the third day that the other regional directors appeared.
Mr. Chairman, the law provides that a regional operation center be set up for this purpose and as a matter of fact, be the one to monitor what is happening in their provincial and municipality jurisdictions. We have a semblance of that operation center at the regional level. Precisely, in this case, they would have been very useful in interceding in behalf of cities like Tacloban. Kasi po, sila po ang direct link ng ating National Council, di po ba?
Yes, Your Honor. Actually, the incident commander was designated and the command post was also positioned at the Tacloban City Police Office. And the incident commander, in the person of Division Commander General Bilarmino, was designated as the incident commander in Region 8. And in that facility, we had our communication set up. That's why we were able to communicate to other areas, except of course in the provincial and municipal level where communication was down.
Mr. Chairman, if I may move to another point. For example, in Yolanda, as highlighted by Mayor Romualdez, one of their problems was they were not able to feed information up the National Council in terms of what was needed in prioritizing, you know, the different activities for the response. One of these was that there were not enough people on the ground to do a rapid needs assessment. What is the policy of the National Council pagdating ho sa ganun? Kasi I understand this is very crucial ho in directing not only aid, but the kind of other equipment, the kind of additional personnel that will be sent to the affected areas. How fast did the National Council, if it was the job of the National Council at this point already, how fast were you able to conduct that rapid needs assessment as soon as the opportunity presented itself?
Well, actually, in 24 hours, we did our damage assessment. When we arrived there on Saturday, with additional troops and communication equipment. And we conduct a damage assessment in the city proper. That's why we immediately sent communications, relief goods, and additional equipment, especially manpower, because nobody's really moving. Not only government agencies, local and national in the region were victims, but basically 90 to 95% of the population.
If I may clarify from Mr. Chairman, from Mayor Romualdez, because I get a sense that what was being prioritized was not reflective of what the local government felt was the priority, as opposed to, of course, your assessment, which also identified what these priorities were. What is now your mechanism to find a balance between the two? Because I would suppose, in a ideal scenario, if the local government had enough people, they would be in a better position, being the first responders, to make such an assessment. How do you find that balance, sir?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Actually, we were on board, both the local and national. Even on the Saturday night meetings and Sunday, the local government and national government were both present. And we were both assessing the situation and providing what is needed.
Before I wrap up, Mr. Chairman, just a few more points. I noted the lessons learned, which was stated in the briefing of OCD a while ago. May I add there, sir, the capability of both the National Council and its operation center, and even up to the level of regional and provincial, to have a very resilient facility. When I say resilient, I am talking about the model of New Zealand. Sa kanila ho, nakabunker ho ang kanilang National Operation Center so that it can withstand any earthquake, any massive conflagration, any flood, and all other disruptions of the normal situation. Bakit ho? Kasi in this case, kapag yung mismong facility na kailangan ho natin to do the assessment, to give feedback to the National Council, to ask for additional help, pag yun ho mismo ang na-wipe out, napakahirap ho talaga to coordinate. Mr. Chairman, may I know from OCD if such plans are already in the pipeline? Because I would suppose as part of the rebuilding process, we would suggest that not only our relocation centers be disaster-proof, but also the operation centers of the DRR units. May we know, Mr. Chairman, from the OCD?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, based on the result and effects of Typhoon Yolanda, I think the direction should be more on the resiliency of our operation centers.
Has this been factored into for the budget of 2014, sir?
We requested satellite phones in the meantime, and we are further making a study on how we can be more resilient, including facilities.
I'm just curious, sir. The current operation center of OCD right now, what type of disasters is it resilient to? What kind of disasters can it withstand to be able to function as the repository of our national decision-making on disasters?
Well, at the moment, our regional centers, if we will look at Yolanda, no regional center can withstand that kind of a typhoon. And I think that should be the benchmark of our future planning and in making our facilities resilient.
Another point, Mr. Chairman, we heard from the briefing that there is a one-stop shop for the processing of relief, both in kind as well as in cash. As an immediate result of the 2004 tsunami, there was a deluge of international aid. However, 6 months after, only 10% of what was committed was released. Are we aware of this? And have we factored this in terms of coordinating with the national government and especially with Congress as to additional funding? Kasi ho, baka nagko-commit ho tayo, we are obligating ourselves to do certain things for reconstruction, eh hindi naman ho dumating yung mga commitments from abroad. Are we, I don't know if who is the proper resource person for this, Mr. Chairman, since we are on the topic of rehab and reconstruction. If there's no one, Mr. Yeah, Chairman, may I suggest that we invite someone?
That is being assessed right now. Initial presentation lang ito eh. Ano? And remember that the objective of this is to pinpoint which law, parts of the law may need to be examined, Mr. Chairman. For example, yung bang power of the local government agencies to declare an emergency. What does it imply? We need to examine that. The power for forced evacuation is another, and then the power to commander in response to the disaster and such other thing. May I ask Mr. Chairman that the chairman of the NDRRMC Council submit an evaluation of the implementing rules and regulations? And may we ask that the committee be provided a copy of the IRR? Kasi nandiyan na ang batas, the strength of that law insofar as implementation is concerned, eh, kulang eh, yung IRR. Ano? For example, who is responsible for the coordination of all the relief distribution? Are there proper authorities to define? Kasi Red Cross, for example, pumasok yan, nag-distribute. Nagkaroon pa nga ng problema yata sa Bohol yan. Ano? Yung mga non-governmental organizations, yung Kapuso, yung Kapamilya, and such other, for example, small groups, are willing to contribute. Who is controlling this? Who is not controlling probably, but coordinating this? Kasi hindi natin malaman kung saan dapat pumunta yung dapat dalhin. Di ba? And that can only come from the assessment. And here, I think the assessment was quite late. If we are addressing the issue of rescue and relief, yung tatlo, reconstruction, rehabilitation, etc., it will come later. Ano? Pero yun, ang immediate concern natin is fast delivery of rescue and relief. Life-saving yun eh. Kaya yun ang una. So, paki-examine nga ninyo, meron bang coordinated information given to non-governmental responders? Red Cross is one. yung mga other non-governmental organizations. So, in the next, I propose, Mr. Chairman, that in the next meeting, remember that this is not a fault-finding session that we have. What we want to do is to examine what happened so that we can incorporate into amendments of the law, if there is such a required action to be taken by Congress, and for Congress to determine whether or not Congress sufficiently provides the executive department to respond in those these five elements of response. Again, I repeat, rescue, relief, rehabilitation, reconstruction, and marami ho tayong i-examine dito. Yung capability ng ating and utilization of the engineering brigades. Isa yan eh. Siguro kung na-deploy kagad natin yung engineering brigades, na-clear kagad yung access to the affected area. Of course, in addition to having the helicopters, you need more C-130s, you need more landing ship type Philippine Navy vessels, yung the capability to deploy mobile clinics, for example, that could save lives. Mobile clinics. I will give you a copy of that ano kung ano ba yung mobile clinic. So, here, our objective to examine everything. You need more laws? Congress should provide. You need more funds? Congress must provide. You need authorization in the distribution of authorities? We need to examine the existing laws. We need to examine implementing rules and regulations para the government will be better in a better position to respond. Remember, ang requirement dyan po, respond. Definition of who is supposed to respond. Frontliners are the LGUs. But do they have the power? Maybe the resources are limited, but the power. For example, what is implied by the power of the local government when they declare an emergency in that locality even before the entry of national government? Do they have sufficient power for forced evacuation, to reduce casualties? Do they have the power to command it? Do they have the power to mobilize non-local government units but are within the area bago pumasok ang national? Kasi kung kailangan ng troops, kailangan pa ba natin ng Secretary of Defense to do that? Kung nando doon, immediately may mga troops na doon. Siguro we need to examine all of this to structure the government's response to this. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, just to formalize the earlier recommendations of Congressman Acedillo, I think you should include the submission of a concept paper regarding the establishment of national operation centers and regional operation centers that would be situated in bunkers. And at the same time, the SND, Secretary Gasmin, should give an honest assessment and evaluation of whether the chain of command was followed based on the design of the law. Because he was supposed to be the one in charge here, and the Secretary of Interior and Local Government is supposed to be the vice chair for the disaster preparedness. So the technically, based on the law, he should not have any authority or personality after the disaster. It should be the Secretary of National Defense again. So, like I said, I believe Secretary Rojas would have a justification for his actions, which hopefully we would hear in the next scheduled hearing. So I think we could start moving on to the other.
May I request that Congressman Acidelio be allowed to wrap up, and then after that, may I ask one of the least attended to area that had been affected, Congresswoman Antonino?
Mr. Chairman.
Be heard too.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I'd like to recognize Senator J.B. Ejercito. Mr. Chairman, I think after one or two questions of Congressman Acidelio, we will be hearing first Senator Bam Aquino, so that we'll have a more equitable distribution of questions. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, may I proceed? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I wrap up, Mr. Chairman, may I just clarify further the request of Chairman Biason as to the submission from the OCD of the IRR. Sir, for the information of this committee as well as for the other LGUs who will be responding to disasters, hopefully not in the same magnitude as Yolanda, pag-submit po ng ating IRR, pwede pong pakisamahan natin. I don't know what to call it, but maybe for lack of a term, may we call it a commentary using the recent disasters of 2013 in a simulation. Ganito, this is what the law says, this is what the IRR says, and this is what should happen on the ground in terms of the coordinative and supervisory relationship between the National Council and the regional, provincial, and municipal city disaster units. Para po malinaw, nakasabi naman ho dun sa ating IRR, which was highlighted po kanina by Chairman Trillanes. And my last point po, and I'm wrapping up already, yung ating pong armed forces, medyo criticized din ho sila, bakit daw kulang yung ginawa. In fairness naman ho dun sa ating armed forces and our soldiers, a few days after the, almost a week after the disaster that Yolanda was hit, and we were able to get hold of the situation reports from the AFP, nakita naman ho natin that immediately pa lang, or even prior to Yolanda, nagkaroon na ho sila ng massive pre-deployment as well as immediate deployment after Yolanda. Ang nangyari lang ho, hindi naman ho binobroadcast ng AFP to, as is characteristic of the armed forces, hindi naman ho binabino-broadcast ang ginagawa nila. That's why people were assuming na wala ho silang ginagawa. It is an unfair criticism, and I would like to clarify, and in fact, I would like to commend the response of the armed forces as well as the other agencies involved. Yun pong sinasabing pagkukulang nila, dahil sa kadahilanan lamang po ng lack of equipment, or in the worst case, hindi ho sila pinayagang mag-deploy to certain areas. In the lack of orders or authority to proceed, of course, they will have to obey. So, again, we commend the armed forces. Pakisabi ho sa ating mga sundalo, we are thankful for their service along with others down in the field. With that, I yield. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Congressman Acidelio. Now, let's hear from...
At yan po ang joint hearing ng Senado at ng Kamara patungkol pa rin sa naging pagresponde ng mga lokal na pamahalaan pati na rin ng disaster agencies sa nangyaring Super Typhoon Yolanda. At sa pagpapatuloy nga ng pagdinig ay inungkat no ang naging papel ng NDRRMC pati na rin ng mga LGU sa naging pagresponde. At sinabi nga ni Congressman Biason na kung may kakayahan man ang mga local government unit, kailangan pa rin ng tulungan sa pagitan ng mga LGU pati na rin ng National Disaster Response Units.